Yes, Mr. Goodman.
Thank you, Lord. Lord, I'm going to address my matters, they'll be brief. The first matter is the question which your lordship raised at the outset, which is whether there was a vacancy when the dispute came before the commission, was there an incumbent? And we believe the position is correctly stated by the chairperson of the commission, Professor Moloneki. Your lordship has bundle 3 of the Rule 53 record. Starts at page 4 and 5.
Final determination is not right.
granted in community approval are unlikely to last. This case is a good example. The current dispute has run for some 80 years. What makes us so certain this court's determination will be the end of the road? These things have to be addressed and addressed very presently. Then, turning to the question of remedy. The first submission I need to make is that this is not an all-paid case. This is not an all-paid case. This is not a dispute about a contract in which the issue is money, in which a court can say, well, the chips have fallen, the dice have fallen where they've fallen, and you're not going to mess with it now. Too long it's gone, too much work has been done, the money's been, work's been done, and paid by payments have been made, we don't interfere. This is a case about the future of the nation. And it's not a matter where I can write it off and say, oh, well, you don't know it was unlawful. I won't make it grant of anything because some of them will pay the price. The question in that context is, which you've also raised, is who is the royal family? And we submit that the royal family, if it's going to be referred back to the royal family, who is the royal family? That's addressed in Justice Froneman's judgment in paragraph 83 and 84. We say that it is the house, the whole of the house, that is who it is. It's his descendants and his line. And we say, this is what Justice Froneman says, paragraph 83, third line. He says, if a correct understanding of the composition of the royal family in its traditional democratic role, looking after the interest of its subjects is given proper thought and currency by all, that need not be the case. The composition of the royal family should not be determined by a particular faction. It should be inclusive. The royal family must, in its traditionally democratic ways, determine the king or queen in the interests of its subjects and not in the material interests of a particular faction. He goes on to say, so there is something to commend making haste slowly. If both current factions understand that they must act as a royal family for the benefit of all their subjects, not merely for themselves or their particular faction, is it not premature for a court to deny customary law a chance to identify a king or queen in its own winning way? And so we submit that if your lordships, if one remedial option which you submitted to your lordship is to the matter should go back to the royal family, your lordship could say so, could endorse what Justice Froneman said in his judgment and said, when I royal family, I mean everybody, both lines. Both camps, not just one camp saying we don't have the spoils. The lordship would say that, would say that's how it needs to be defended, it needs to be dealt with, and the royal family could deal with it. And as we know that there's wisdom when people gather and deal with things in their own place and their own. That's what needs to be allowed to happen. That is the case. There is an alternative, and your lordship has pointed out, and we're grateful to your lordship for that, that the members of the commission's, the terms of office of the members of the commission have expired. That doesn't mean there's no statutory body such as the commission. It still exists in the act. It's simply empty in the sense it's legally, the commission legally exists, but the positions on it are vacant because the terms of office of the members have passed and have elapsed. And so one of the possibilities, the alternative possibility of the royal family is for the president to appoint a new commission, new members to the commission, to say to the commission, it's your job now to deal with this. Those are things to us are the only two options if the court is with us on the merits. We don't ask for substitution or we don't ask for the lordship to make the decision. It's the first time in my life I've heard a respondent complain that the applicant doesn't ask for substitution, but we wouldn't ask for substitution because it's not a matter of respect for the court to decide. This is a matter to be decided according to custom, in a customary manner. And so that's the two remedies remaining. Then, my lord, one comes to the question of popularity. And my learned friend says, well, how is it going to be decided? Who's going to decide who's popular? But, my lord, it's part of the customary law that popular support, popularity is an unfortunate word, popular support, popular will, is at the heart of the appointment of customary leaders. And there's no use in the learned friend. I don't understand how my learned friend can say, how is it going to be decided? It will be decided in the customary way, in the usual way. It doesn't involve a vote. It involves consultation and discussion and debate and decision emergence. And if, of course, it's a matter which the Commission could have answered. The Commission could have said, well, who is the popular leader? What is the extent of the support? What is the popular want? Who does the community want as its king? And so,
Mr. Barton, I assume I am to follow what you are saying now. And the letter goes back to the new condition of Africa.
Yes.
It will be popularity of who against who?
The popularity of indeed before the well, now, well, if the court was deciding the dispute as it existed when the complaint was made, and that's the matter which is being set aside, we'd have to decide that dispute between justice and justice.
Yes, if we adopt that approach.
If we adopt that, like, yes.
Yes.
And then,
but if I adopt the approach proposed by the respondent, that the actual dispute started, in fact, in 1989, on the death of Mpondo, who died without any issue. Well, she had a girl after that who was not, a female who was not allowed at that time. But if I start the dispute then, where it was Nelson versus Booth and come through, how is that going to happen?
Well, what the Commission would say, we don't say that what happened in 1939 is irrelevant. Of course it bears on the question. The Commission sitting today, was the Commission sitting at the time when the Commission sat before justice passed away, would have to say to itself two things. Firstly, it would say, what is actually the traditional rule, the customary rule? Is it correct that under custom, whether it was wrongly appointed, or was he in fact appointed correctly? That's step one. Then it would say, that doesn't dispose of the matter. Now he has been another paramount chief for 20 or 30 years. Now we say when he was appointed, what should have been done? If Huerta was wrongly appointed, then the formal rules were against Mpondo. But that's not the only thing we have to consider. We have to consider, was he the popular choice at that time? And how did the two weigh up against each other? On the one hand, the rule which would be against him, on the other hand, his popularity which would be in favor of him, and how do we assess it in a way? And that's how the community makes its decisions when it decides whether to deviate from the rules. So even if your lordship, even if the Commission found that the 39 decision was wrong, which we don't concede, but even if the Commission found that, there would still be a question, okay, what should they have done? What should have happened in 1978? And in 1978, the uncontested evidence is that popular acceptability was a key test, that it's undisputable on the evidence. It's common cause evidence. Popular acceptability is part of the test of appointment. We know as a matter of fact that justice had it, it was popularly acceptable for the reasons which we've been through, and the Commission had the evidence of it. And that would have to be taken into account. Of course, that's what the Commission ought to have done. It should have said, if its findings on 1939 were correct, it should have said, what happened in 1939 was wrong. Now, how does that weigh in to the decision today? And how do we play that as the undoubted popular support for the meeting? And of course, they would have to say, is Zanozuko a popular choice? And it just says, what popular support he had. All of that would go into the mix, and his popularity today would be relevant. So what we're saying is that it's not a matter of trying to scramble the elements, it's saying what are all the relevant considerations. One relevant consideration is what the customary law represents. described it as the line of succession in that ultimate. Another relevant consideration is what was the popularity, the popular acceptability of the different contenders in 1979. Decisions. The problem with what the commission did was it said something wrong was done in 1939, that's the only one. And so we say, we make the submission that that fatal flaw remains and it remains unanswered. The only answer raised by our living friends is to suggest that Mpondo didn't rely on the fact that he was the popular choice. But what was the point of all this evidence? He gave the evidence that he'd been unanimously supported for appointment on nomination by Nelson. He gave evidence that he'd won an election which was held. He gave evidence that he was supported by 25 of the 28 senior traditional leaders. And he gave evidence that he'd ruled peacefully and effectively for more than 20 years without any trouble. The only relevance of that evidence was to his popular acceptability. And it was for the commission, as the experts, to recognize that this was a valid basis for asserting and defending his decision, and to say, we have regard to that, we have regard to what happened in 1939, our view on what happened in 1939 is the following, and in the light of that we say this is A or B, is the person who should be the tradition, who should be the king. But what it couldn't do is simply say something happened in 1939, genealogy applies from the beginning of the matter was squarely before commission, the evidence was there, it ignored it. And we say that the commission had to deal with the facts before them failed to do so. So we say that popularity was part of it. It's not actually. The professor acknowledges the popularity that the genealogical rules are bent or overruled or deviated from in order to accommodate popular will. But they ignored it. It's very ironic, I must say, that the learned friend made a great play in his remarks about the alleged unpopularity of Buddha, which he's clearly thought way into the picture. Now, the evidence of that is thin indeed, and there's contradictory evidence of that. But if that evidence is relevant, then how can the proved popularity of the Mpondo be simply ignored as irrelevant? It's relevant in defending the decision which was made, it's relevant in defending the attack of the decision in 1939. How can it not be relevant in the attack on the commission's decision in the 2000s? With respect, it's quite fundamentally contradictory. It was for the commission to assess the evidence and to reach a conclusion instead of being. Then the learned friend says that the relief we seek now is limited. It is limited. It's limited in the light of the decisions of the Constitutional Court, and it still bears down on the same core relief. The core relief is to set aside the decision of the Commission, to set aside the appointment of Zanozuko. That's always been part of the matter. The other challenge is a four-year-old right of the evolution of the case. It's not a new case, it's the same case, but the same core relief. Then, a learned friend says that the Lordship has heard no argument on irrationality or unreasonableness. This is just an appeal, dressed up as a review. No, it's not. We say that in the Pajo there have been two failures on the fundamental kind. There's been a failure to have regard to a relevant consideration, namely the question of popular acceptability. And we say there's been a failure to apply the customary law of the AmaMpondo, which is what the statutory function is of the Commission. The statutory function of the Commission is to have regard to the customary law of the AmaMpondo. It didn't do so. It was ignored the question of popular acceptability. Those are review grounds, they're not appeal grounds. That brings me to nearly the last point, which is my learned friend says, correctly draws attention to the fact that the Commission has to deal with the customary law as it existed at the time. But the customary law as it existed at the time is the community's customary law, not the impositions of the apartheid regime. And so, if the 1939 appointment was externally imposed and impermissible under customary law, which we don't consider, if it was, that didn't change the community's customary law. The community's customary law remained the community's customary law, which is that people people are chosen according to principles. They're chosen by the community, by the royal family, the tests of the popular will. And the popular will is critical, and the rules are not binding. The rules are not inflexible. That was the customary law of the community all along. It has been the customary law of the community since time immemorial. That Professor Baynard's history, he shows it goes back for 200 years. That's not changed by an arbitrary decision by a Governor General signing the Gazette in 1939. The customary law of the community at the time of the decision was the customary law of the community. That's the living customary law which we were all told by the Constitution as well as we apply. So, the Chair, that's the law. Then we're told, your lordship is told that what your lordship is asked is to condone and compound the 1938 amendment. That's not right. What your lordship is asked to do is to have regard to the 1938 amendment, but look at the position that existed on the ground in 1978 when Mpondo really was appointed, because that was the decision which was made. And that's the decision which is effective. Of course, one may say, if one takes that view, then that decision is affected by the 1938 decision and its validity, but it's not an overriding consideration. It comes back to, with respect, the same genealogical dominoes game, that because it should have been Nelson, so it said, therefore should have been his son, therefore should have been his grandson, therefore it should be his own son. No questions asked. That's not how the customary law operates. It's not what the customary law provides for. Finally, my lord, on the question of the costs.
But before we get to cost,
yes,
we do concede that the question of genealogy also is part of customary.
Absolutely. Don't dispute that. It's a material factor, and it has to be weighed as it against with other factors. And the critical factor of political acceptability. And again, I can only refer you, I've shown your lordship what was said by the chairperson, who made his final affidavit, when he said, it's paragraph 103 of his affidavit, he says, of course it must be accepted, I think you've watched it on this page 122 he says, it talks about the rules, and then paragraph 103, he says, of course, it must be accepted that in some cases, communities have altered their customs for pragmatic reasons or created convenient exceptions in others. This would allow the identification of someone that the community prefers. And that's what the Commission failed to do. The Commission failed to have regard to the question. In the light of the facts, should there be an exception in order to allow the identification of someone that the community prefers, which is consistent with its, because that is consistent with its custom. That was the fundamental failure of the Commission, and that's why it's not necessary to go to the We asked therefore for an order, as we asked for the funding, we asked for the amendment, which is not opposed. We asked for the admission of the evidence of Dr. Clausens, and arguments submitted by my learned friend in that regard go to the weight of the evidence to be attached to the evidence. They don't go to the admissibility of the evidence at all. They go to the proposition that you want to try and say, well, that's what she says, but I don't agree with them. I don't think it applies in the present case for the following reasons. It doesn't go to admissibility, so they don't have to. The David should be admitted. And without wanting to be disrespectful, if this case goes further, as I fear it may, whatever the outcome, that evidence should be before it will be seized with the meetings of abortions. And so we ask for the admission of the affidavit. We ask for the costs of those two applications, the application for amendment and the application for the admission of the evidence of Dr. Parsons.
And the cost of the
amendment. The amendment.
Well, the application, but it's only.
Well, we had to come here and argue. Well, we're not going to make any point. We're not going to. We ask the application for the admission of the evidence is opposed. And we're therefore entitled to our costs. And if your lordship is with us on the admission of the evidence.
their contribution to the submissions made. They have clarified quite a number of areas that I was concerned about. And I'm going to reserve the judgment here. I cannot give a date as to when it will be delivered, given the nature of the volume of work in this division. But I'm mindful of the fact that both sides agree that this is a very important case and in which a number of people have interest. And I'm going to try and deliver this judgment in this term. Still, that's what I'll do. But if I don't succeed, then definitely the next term. Okay, thank you very much.